Good evening. Welcome to the 5-8, where we discuss each of the week's five most fucked up topics for 8 minutes. So, five topics, 8 minutes, two hosts, no guests today, some singing, a lot of curse words, and as many cocktails as we deem necessary. LB, how are you?
I'm okay. I think I'm good. Yeah. Good. I'm slightly under the weather, so if I have to bend down with my Kleenex, that's what I'm doing. Just taking care of a little bit of sinus. But I feel fine. You know, okay. How are you? You have a very different backdrop going on.
I do. I am in Midtown Manhattan. Mm-hmm. And I was not planning on being in Midtown Manhattan, but I had to emergency chaperone. My son went to a concert with his friend. So here I am drinking in Manhattan. In Manhattan. You want to guess how much Manhattan in Manhattan costs?
23. Oh, is it 30?
$30. I could have bought, I should have brought an entire bottle of whiskey and it would have been cheaper. It's kind of ridiculous, but
All right. We're at the $30 mark now.
Uh-huh. Yeah, we're there. We're at the $30 mark.
This is a cheap month for hotel rooms, at least. It's, you know, February is discount month. Yeah.
It's not, I don't know. I did not arrange this. I just my wife handled all the logistics. I just came here. And they were staying in a hotel that was the hotel that I usually stay at when I'm at here for the coin show. And so I know this hotel very well. It's the same one. I had to like move it a little bit so it looks slightly different than it does the other couple times I've done the show in this hotel. Feels like the same room, but I don't think it's the same room.
It looks like the same color palette. We definitely recognize you there. Yeah. So, yeah, okay.
Yeah, I think so. It's not so bad.
It's nice and warm today. It's balmy in New York today.
No yeah, it's not bad. I didn't have to wear my hat. It was okay.
Yeah.
It was okay.
Good.
So do you want to talk about, before we get to the topics at hand, you want to talk about what you've been up to this week or no? Or is that secret?
Oh, I can't believe you're bringing this. You mean, I don't know what I think you're talking about.
I think so.
I mean, you can. I haven't planned on. And
you're like, everybody. I'm so embarrassed. You came on here with a red mask looking like Hannibal Lecter. In front of the whole world.
Yeah, but that's like, you know. All right. So it's my North Country adventure. Not the True Detective Night Country, the North Country. I just decided, part of my changing life up here. There's a lot of winter here. And even though we had a very mild winter here, I was like, I need a winter activity. I need something that I look forward to doing so that the winter months, I have something that I'm like, yay, it's winter. Cause I'm from California. Right. And so, and I'm loving it. I love the change of seasons, all of that kind of stuff. So I decided, I don't know how I got this in my head, but I'm like, I'm going to ice skate. I think I can do that. I have never ice skated in my life. I really haven't. I think there was like a birthday party when I was six or something at the ice skating rink. But I used to roller skate and I rollerbladed and I thought, well, I could do this. So I get out on the ice. Oh, it was it. Am I telling the whole story? Oh, whatever.
Yeah, but tell the whole story.
Where I live is where the miracle on the ice happened. The 1980s Olympics with the hockey team and all that.
Wait, so who did we beat?
The what?
Who did we beat in the miracle on ice?
Russia.
Oh, wow. Yeah, right. A bunch of amateur Americans. For the show. Fucking ass. Okay,
so continue. I hadn't been inside the Olympic Center, that part of it. There's a lot of Olympics all over the place here, but I hadn't been at the center. So I went inside and it's gorgeous. It's such a jewel. This town really understood how to be, they know how to be an Olympic town. They've had several Olympics here and it's part of the town identity. And everywhere you go, there's these Olympic athletes and these world-class athletes. And, you know, you're just sort of like, anyway, so I go into the big place and they're like, well, you can take a lesson today, if you'd like. We're having a President's Day week special and you get to do it on the miracle rink. And I'm like, oh, I get to go on the miracle rink and learn to ice skate. Okay. That sounds kind of like a moment. So I show up for the, it was like a group lesson open for people, right, for this thing. I was the only one to show up. It's very busy there. Not that that's ever happened before, that only one person showed up. So there were three instructors. One of the guys is like a former figure skating dancer, like a champion, blah, blah, blah. His name is Jeff LeBrake. And so they taught me how to skate. It's like an hour. I took my dad. He loved it. He was like, it's just like 50 years. God, I'm watching my kid do something he's never done before and learn how to do it. And then I decided I liked it. It is nothing like roller skating. It is nothing like rollerblading. Those skills helped me not in one iota.
Maybe a little bit.
No. I'm really being serious. I'm telling you. No. It's just a totally different thing. It's kind of scary. It's really hard, very hard. And then, you know, Jeff LeBlake, the fancy guy, he's like, you're pretty good. You should come to this other thing. So I'm like, okay, maybe I'll ice skate now. So I went another time. So twice this week, and that was like an hour and a half. The first one was like 2 hours. This is like, I'm having all this ice skating. So I'm very sore and I'm very tired. And that's probably why I have the sniffles and I'm a little sick. But I did get my ice skates and they're coming. So I don't know. I'm an ice skater, I guess. I don't know.
That's exciting. I had forgotten about the miracle on ice. I didn't realize it was that. So you've communed on land, or rather ice, I suppose, where we defeated Russia.
That's right.
I feel like that's appropriate. I feel like there's something symbolic there.
I think so. And it really was, we really were the underdogs. I don't know that if you're not, you got to be kind of as old as you and I to remember this, or older. That was such a big, like, and I never saw the movie. I should probably see the movie, but it's, I lived it, you know, like, you know, and my family worked that Olympics too, because they were living here. And it's, we were truly, America was not the shining city on the hill yet. I don't even think that had fallen out of Ronald Reagan's mouth yet. Because he came, didn't he start in 80? Not 81. When was
he started in 81.
81.
Yeah.
So this was before all of that. And America was just sort of like, I mean, yes, we did great in World War II. And we came in and we felt like we were this big thing. And we had this Cold War going with Russia. But they kind of kicked our ass in everything that was sports and Olympics. And
well, that's also because they sent the professionals. They sent professional athletes. They and we sent like, you know,
they doped them up. Right. And they almost beat us in the space race. They kind of did in a way. And then we got to the moon. Like, it was like they were formidable. And we were not supposed to win at all in this Olympics. And this scrappy little USA hockey team had a miracle on the ice. They beat the, they made it to the finals, and then they beat the Russians. And that really turned everything around. And America all of a sudden was like, people were looking at us, oh my God, maybe they are powerful. Maybe they can be great. It sounds silly, but guys, it really was one of those moments where sports shifted global, the sort of the global stage, right? And the dynamic and the sentiments out there. So yeah, it's a special rink. You can feel it. It's a beautiful, beautiful rink. I mean, my God, skating on that rink is a privilege. Now, I was only looking straight down at the ice the whole time. So I got a couple moments I would stop and kind of look around and take it in. But I'll be back. I'll be back on the Miracle Rink. Maybe I'll do a trick.
I'd love to
learn a trick.
Get some video. We need some video for the 5'8 here. We need to see video.
You're not. I did share some video with you. And if you share that video, I will never.
I would never do that. I would never.
You cannot.
I'm not. I'm not into that sort of thing, you know.
Humiliation.
Yes. I don't roll that way. So while you were busy doing that and having this great experience at the ice rink, this is what was happening in my house, which is that every February on some random day, the skunks come out. And they breed, and while they breed, the smell, they spray like, I don't know what happens.
Terrible. I'm so sorry for you.
Two days ago, we woke up, and the whole house like reeked of skunk. Like real, it was so bad that it was almost like a concentrated onion smell. It was just awful. So what happened, my office is like ground zero of skunk land. I think they live right under my desk, actually. I think they burrow down.
You gotta get them out of there. You gotta get them out of there.
They've lived in the house longer than, and it's not just like, they go all around the neighborhood. They when they're protecting the young, they sort of spin around the kids while they're walking. It's really weird and interesting to look at.
I mean, they're beautiful and you can't harm them, but you need to get them out of your house.
Well, you know, it's, we're just living on their land. Who are we? You know? So anyway, yeah, you, everywhere. So
are they paying your mortgage? Are they paying your mortgage?
Yeah. You know, they spray and then the tax guy runs away. You know, it's, that's what happened. So anyway, it's a weird thing because, 1 year it happened like the night, right before I was going to go to Berlin. So like, I didn't have time to do anything. So all my clothes were packed and then I got to Berlin and I opened the suitcase. Everything stunk.
This that is was, an awful thing.
One of my
thing.
Kids had to go to the nurse to change clothes. My wife was doing therapy at a drug center at that time for you know, for her work. And she walked by and people were like, oh, somebody's smoking pot in here.
You're the skunk.
She had to run out and buy a new shirt at lunch. That was the worst one. This one wasn't quite as bad.
Oh my God.
I don't know.
I had a better week.
I think, yes. I think skunk wise, certainly. Yeah. I think, you know, can the skunks beat the Russians? I don't know. Are there Russian skunks? Do Russians have skunks? They just have marmots?
I did ponder quite seriously. Could you die, pass away from a smell?
No, because I think that
the smell would be so bad that that's it. I have a very sensitive nose. I can smell.
So does my wife. So does my wife. But you get used to it after a while. You're just like, you know, whatever. So
there's got to be a plot we can write around all of this. All right.
It's a weird thing. So tonight's show.
Yes. Okay. We're burning airtime, folks, but we don't have a guest because we're doing it neat.
Yeah. We often have to rush through the banter here at the beginning. So tonight we do not have to. And you and I often talk a lot in the week leading up to the show and certainly on the day of the show. And we have not really talked very much.
I was ice skating.
Yeah. And there was stuff going on. I woke up this morning. I wrote a piece about anti-tax movements. I went to work. I went to the train station. I've been very busy. And, you know, I had to chaperone, I had to go to Grand Central, the whole nine yards. So
that's a lot. Anyway, it's a lot.
I think the theme of the show here is going to be like, we're going to like talk about the topics and share what we think about what's happening.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the idea. So, do you have the time?
Oh, God, my job, my one job.
Or did it fall while you were ice skating and now you don't have it?
No, mm-mm. It didn't fall. Okay, here we go. Timer's on.
Okay, so the first topic, The Russia House, which is a novel by John le Carré, but this is a perfect title for the segment because it's Russia and it's the House of Representatives, and whoop, they're smushed together somehow. So I feel like everything's been moving so fast news-wise lately that we have to step back and kind of exhale with this and kind of sit with it for a while to fully appreciate what is going on.
Yeah.
The Republicans on oversight, which is Comer and Jordan, okay? More about them in a minute, but they have been Hunter Bidening. They're like the skunks spraying Hunter Biden all over, right? They're just, that's all they do. And last week we knew that the guy's name that was the key witness was Smirnoff, which is just, again, simulation breaking
down. I still can't get past it.
And this week we found out that Smirnoff, go figure, a guy named Smirnoff has ties to Russian intelligence.
Imagine that.
So this guy was feeding information to these two fucking imbeciles that was just straight up Kremlin propaganda, just straight up. Just it went, it's again, it's the human centipede. It goes from the Kremlin to Alexander Smirnoff to these two idiots, Jordan and Comer. Now, I just like, I don't even know what to say. Like those two guys, Jim Jordan, he had the whole wrestling thing. We know what happens when people are breaking the law around him. He just turns the other way. He doesn't want anything to do with it.
Yeah.
He's now made and Comer, I mean, that guy is the creepiest looking guy. Like, I don't know what they have on him, but nothing would surprise me just looking at him. I mean, he looks like he stepped out of central casting for like horrible, horrible, like, politician who does creepy shit. And and now they're working with the Russians, whether they know they knew they were or not. I mean, they should know they are, because they should know that this story is complete.
I don't know if they would have their jobs if they weren't. I mean, I think I go to that place. It's like, you know, who are you? Where did you come from? And, even Jim Jordan has been around, like, somebody with that is why go into politics? Why did any of these people go into politics to just be, there's a calling there. You know, we've got this new wave of politicians coming in, new people coming in, and they, because they're having the reaction to the Trump era of like, God, I can't just take democracy for granted anymore. I got to get involved. I got to get in there. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe I'll do it. I'll run for school board. You had a lot of calls from people like, look, just go do a local thing, get involved, get engaged. We've slept on it. We slept on democracy. We thought we were just rolling through and it was all going to work and we didn't have to do anything. And now we've learned, oh shit, we're still vulnerable. Let's get it. You know, maybe I can be of service. These guys.
Yeah, they're not. I mean,
The black president? Is that what activated them? I mean, they could just be that basically horrible, but why? You could have.
Jordan looks like a caveman. He's this misshapen skull.
Could have just run a Foot Locker and had as much, you know, satisfaction. Like, what? Why did you choose politics? Where did you come from? Who identified that you would be a great candidate? How did you win? Where did your campaign money come from? You're in there on day one from the get-go, as we look back and we learn about these people with, you know, Comer, you're in there day one with shit from our enemies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Marjorie Taylor Greene asked for a pardon before she even took office.
Before she took office, she was needing a pardon.
Yeah, she's another one. And then, just to continue along in this house here, we have this Mike Johnson guy who every week goes by, he seems to get more and more bad. And we knew it was a little scary when the only reason he's there is because Matt Gaetz did the thing for some reason to get rid of Kevin McCarthy, mostly because they did not want to fund Ukraine. They didn't want us to get paid to Ukraine. That was the one thing that
that's the one thing.
Yeah, and I don't know who would benefit from us not helping Ukraine? I don't know. Who could it be?
Who could it be?
I don't know.
Who would have that as their number one thing? With all the domestic stuff that we've got going on, with all the wedge issues that actually work for GOPers to bleat and moan about and so outraged for all the stuff that they could, that even would work with, you know, the old school Republicans, that they could embrace and let's get more tax cuts. You know, let's really be horrible to everybody who's black and brown and not WASPs. They could have kept on that train, right? So many hosts of domestic and even global issues. Why just that one and nothing else? Fuck it. This is our one thing. We're single issue politicians now, and our single issue is whatever Putin wants. That's true.
It's true. And it's not, this isn't conspiracy talking. This is what they're fucking doing. They will not vote for that. They're not going to do it. No. Why? It helps everybody in the Western world to defeat Putin.
Yeah.
But the GOP.
They're not going to lose a single voter by voting for it. They might even gain some. That's my point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. If there's one thing politicians need, it's votes. You know, they'll do stuff for votes. So, yeah, it's very curious. Now, the other interesting thing that happened is that Paul Ryan, remember him?
Came
down from the C-suite of the Fox News board and gave an impassioned, hey, we have to help Ukraine speech, to which I say and said on Twitter, and people actually saw it for once, hey, fuck off, Paul Ryan. You knew what was happening in 2016 and probably earlier with Ukraine. You knew what Russia was up to. Where you been this whole time?
We got you on tape knowing it.
Yes, we do. He was the Speaker of the House, which means that he had access to all the House intelligence stuff, which means that everything that Devin Nunes did, he tacitly greenlighted. Mm-hmm. He could have replaced Nunes whenever he wanted. Whenever he chose wanted. Not to.
That's right.
Want to know what my theory is? Why he's saying this now?
Why?
I have a theory. Okay. I think that his,
I don't know this theory, everybody.
Okay. I think his kids are old enough now that they know what time it is, as this Heritage Foundation guy likes to say. They know what time it is. And Paul Ryan is trying to save face so that he can look his kids in the eye. That's what I think. I think he feels bad. I think he's ashamed of himself. And he's trying to, you know, just claw ever so slightly back so he can tell his kids, see what I did? But like, come on. And people on Twitter were like, well, isn't it great that they came out and they're supporting us now? And it's like, is it? Who is that convincing? Like who? His kids. Nobody else listens to this fucking guy.
He's going for the TikTok approval. Unbelievable. Yeah. Unbelievable. Wait till his kids find out who Dennis Hastert is. Let's see what happens then.
How we doing on time? Oh, look at that.
There, what do you know?
8 minutes, it's just one of those things. It's like I start Stairway to Heaven in my brain, and we wind on down the road, and here we go.
All right. Second topic, you've got Alabama shakes.
Would you like to guess what this is about?
I mean, I don't know. I think you should start this one because it's so appalling. I did see what happened in Alabama. Let me do a couple of little highlights just because this was one of the news items I caught punditry talking about. I was watching Morning Joe and having my coffee, and Mika's on, and she says, she kind of went for it. And it was so lovely to see a woman broadcaster at that level just go for what this is really all about. So she's like, you know, it's always these crusty old men that no one would touch. I was like, oh.
That's like you say. That's something you would say. Yeah.
That's right. You know, the crusty, disgusting, you know, they're all the same guy. They're all the same guy. She's going. And it's true. This is the great unfuckable horde that are, you know, so old that they're whatever. I mean, look, this whole thing from back into the 80s of this crazy, we're going to call it pro-life, which is, you know, we're going to do our provoskaya, right? Like, it's like, we'll take the thing that, and we'll twist it and invert it and put it out there and have an offensive thing. And, you know, very Kremlin from the get-go. I'm sure there'll be a point in time where we'll have enough breadcrumbs leading that all the way there to the Kremlin of like, this, choose this wedge issue. This will get, this is how you weaponize people's brains. You just make it all about the children and, oh my God, they're killing children. And here's some fake fucking shit, video shit you can show people. And we'll just, if you think about the disinformation around abortion from the 80s to today and how highly weaponized that was and what a bag of bullshit all that information was and what abortion is and what it's about, and it couldn't be a healthcare thing. And it just, how the conservative movement latched onto that, the evangelicals got radicalized by that into becoming eventually Trumpers. It all does come back to that, this sort of single issue of, oh my God, this emotional abandonment, just reckless abandonment of not just science and fact and caring about women's health and things that are about our freedoms and democracy, like having autonomy over our own bodies, but just abandonment of reality.
Yeah.
Just total fantasy.
Mm-hmm.
Childish emotional, you know, when you see these people, these pro-lifers, as they call themselves, the level of rapture they get themselves up involved in when they're foaming at the mouth to save the frozen embryos that are really the babies, right? Which is where we're at now with this Alabama ruling. And it just, it's a level of idiocy, just sheer idiocy. All of the beliefs behind all that crap that's about just stripping women of their rights and pulling us out of any form of progress that we've made as leaders, as thinkers, as providers for our own families, for ourselves and our own families. It's just this clawing back of, you will be right under our fucking thumb back in the kitchen and pregnant. You're here to make our babies. And that's it. That's your only value and your only worth. Because that's what it was about, and not about, oh, life. We have to save life, right? It's been a lie from day one. It's been a fantasy from day one. It's been bullshit and horseshit from day fucking one. It just has. Yeah. So inevitably, something, a movement or whatever we want to call this garbage that is based on that foundation is going to get itself into its own fucking cul-de-sac of gobbledygook. And that's what this Alabama ruling is, to the degree to where the Alabama senator, who Tuberville, who is not, he's not bright.
You're talking about a guy who went 500 in egg bowls during his time at Ole Miss. So watch.
Yes, that's true. And he really loves Vladimir Putin. Like, he is all in for Putin. He is.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also dumb as a pile of rocks. You know, didn't even understand when he was being interviewed about this ruling. And what it was the Alabama Supreme Court, just to catch everybody up, I'm sure you all know, ruled that frozen embryos are babies, because someone who was working in an IVF fertility lab accidentally mishandled some embryos. So they were lost somehow. I don't know if they spilled it. I don't know what the details of that, but this is what happened. The want to be parents. They're not parents. Maybe they were parents of living children, but an embryo, frozen embryo, is just a whatever. The individuals who provided the embryo and the sperm, or the egg and the sperm for this to be an embryo at this clinic, then sued the clinic and said, "You killed our babies. Those were our babies, and you killed them." And it went all the way up to the Alabama Supreme Court, which is a fucked up court. And they said, yep, embryos are babies. We're going to rule that frozen embryos are babies. And now that's in a Supreme Court ruling, a state Supreme Court ruling, but other states can, since our Supreme Court's like, yeah, we have nothing to do with this. You know, we understand that women are, you know, over 50% of the population in terms of the citizenry, that we're supposed to be out here ruling on stuff. But because it's women, we don't really treat them. They're, what are we? Are we three? We're not three quarters. What were we? We were just not people, right? We're going to go back to the times of say that these aren't people, they're not citizens, and therefore we don't have to do anything to give them bodily autonomy. Just let the states decide. There's nothing about being a woman that makes you a citizen of the United States on a federal level to where we would be. And there's nothing about the Constitution that we have to rule on because you're women. So we'll just push it down to the states. Let the states do that. It's the states. So the states are ruling, and Alabama has made this ruling. So Tuberville's being interviewed. Did I set this stupid timer? I did. It's about to go off. Tuberville's being interviewed, and he didn't even understand that it was his own state giving a Supreme Court ruling that, of this craziness, this crazy fucked up fantasy that's now going to prevent people who want to be parents from being parents.
Yep.
Because the clinics are like, we're not fucking doing this anymore. Right?
Yeah.
It's done. Of course it was going to go all the way around the cul-de-sac of garbledygook, nonsensical idiocy horseshit. And then right back into a massive contradiction with itself. There's been all kinds of contradictions in this pro-life movement, like how they embrace the NRA and they embrace everybody, even children having guns and posing in front of Christmas trees with a gun, but and killing and taking life, but it, you know, or avoiding taking care of children who might be hungry in America, who might be living in poverty in America, who might need better resources for education in America, you know. No, living children, no. But these frozen, now these frozen fucking embryos in a lab, that we're going to go to the mats for and protect that.
Yeah.
So, and what is it going to do? It's going to prevent life.
Yeah.
Which in the arena that they said they were going to protect it. Not in the classrooms. They don't give a about it there. They don't give a shit. They don't give a shit about life anywhere. They don't give a shit about mother's life. Care about a mother's life.
No, they don't.
So anyway, that's my big long. I didn't even think I was had all that in me. I was just like, I don't want to talk about this.
I knew you would.
I just like, you know, so this fucking guy, he doesn't even know. He thinks it's something they're voting on. He doesn't understand it's his own Supreme Court in the state that he represents. It's like he's that fucking dumb.
To be fair, Tommy Tuberville thought that IVF was a draw play that you can use in football on like third and long. He has no fucking idea. He does. Like the running back, fullback going to go out to the, you know, fucking dumbass. Just a complete dumbass. Obviously, a frozen embryo is not a fucking person. Duh. Fucking morons. What you were saying about... It's a fairy tale. The whole abortion is, you're killing a baby. No, you're not. It's settle down. The ancients all thought, and all astrology is based on, that life begins when you take your first breath, by the way. That's what all the ancients thought. That's what the Bible teaches, for fuck's sake. And astrology, which is even older, in which they all believed in at that time. So why do these guys get the right to say, no, we're going to, you know, conception day? Like, none of this makes any sense. And now... That whole thing, you're killing a life, even though most of the time when abortions happen, it's not a viable fetus, it's an ectopic pregnancy. There's all these reasons that are medically necessary to save the mother why women have abortions. It's not as simple as these fucking idiots would like you to believe. It just isn't. And I think that one thing that's been abundantly clear since Dobbs is that it's not. The silver lining in this fucking stupid thing that's going to hurt a lot of people is that the dumber and the worse this shit looks, the more people are going to vote for Biden, because this election is going to be a referendum on Dobbs. And I know that, and this case doesn't happen without Dobbs. Somebody pointed this
out.
Without Dobbs, this case can't happen. This is going to be a referendum on Dobbs. And I know like Ezra Klein and people like that are like tired of thinking about that. Because, let me come up with another fantasy where Biden's going to go off the thing and we're going to settle down, dude. You don't know what the fuck. You watch too many West Wings on crack or something. Just sit down and shut the fuck up. This is going to be, you know who hasn't forgotten about Dobbs? Women, people who are affected by it. Young men, women, the parents of people that will be affected by it. This election is going to be a referendum on Dobbs, and people are going to be shocked at what a fucking blowout it's going to be. Nobody's going to vote for Trump, who is on the stump saying, I'm the one that did Dobbs. Like,
yeah.
People don't like this, you fucking idiot. Ugh. My God. Getting back to the frozen part.
Yeah.
This is the part that really, I mean, now let's, this goes to the Supreme Court, right?
We're back on ice. This is the other subject of the whole thing. We're ever on ice. We're back to ice here.
Who's going to be arguing it?
ICE is
who's going to argue it for the Supreme Court? Obviously, unfrozen caveman lawyer. It has to be him. I'm just a caveman, unfrozen in time. I don't understand all your IVF, but I know that, you know, that it's a fucking SNL sketch. It's that stupid. That's all.
That's a really good sketch. I think we might need a fake ad out of that.
I love Phil Hartman, man, as you know.
I know. I do too.
We didn't even talk about SCOTUS doing that. SCOTUS, you know, they do this shit now where these corporations...
Are we on to the next topic?
No, not yet. I don't know.
Oh, we're still in Alabama. Okay, no,
wait. We'll talk about it.
I didn't know if you were pivoting. I was going to set the timer. Well, look. Pivot.
Amy Comey Barrett wants IVF to be illegal. All of Mike Pence's kids are IVF. Okay. I learned that too, which is interesting.
Well, I mean, it is, it's, you know, here's one last thing I'll say is, remember the women that were showing up in the Handmaid's Tale to, as part of their activism, to protest, you know, the Trump's, Brett Kavanaugh, Coney Barrett, all, everything that was going on, and were called hysterical. And there were people like, don't show up in that. That's just that garb, you know, that like, that's just so, that's just a fantasy. That's just, it's like, yeah, it's happening. It's happening. Yeah. If you don't think that these would, like, again, listen to Tuberville, believe what comes out of their mouths, that they mean it.
Amy Coney Barrett wants it to be illegal.
She wants it to be illegal because it's not God's will, right? Tuberville is simultaneously saying, we need more babies, we need more babies. I'm like, who's we?
Yeah.
We got a lot of babies in this. Are you talking about, are you going there with the great replacement? Because it sounds like you're going there with a great replacement, Mr. Tuberville. Sounds like you're.
I mean, he was the coach of a
little bit of a Nazi, a little bit of a white supremacist there. Who's we? And why do we need more babies? What are you talking about?
Yeah.
So maybe he's been mixing it up with the League of the South down there, which is again a Kremlin fronted, as we learned back in 2018, I think. Confederate white supremacy organization that was funded right out of Russia.
Wow.
Funny how that happens.
Give it up for Alabama though, for engaging and perpetuating the stereotype that Alabama's fucking dumb. Good job, Alabama.
Good job, Alabama.
Good job.
Never going there.
Should we move on?
Yeah, let's move on.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so this is the tomorrow is the 2-year anniversary of the invasion of Ukraine. And we've talked about that a lot on the show. We've had Zarina on, we've had Victor Rudd on. You know, we like to call attention to it because we think it's important. So I just want to talk about that because in the wake of Navalny dying now, Biden has come out with more sanctions. And the Europeans have also sanctioning. It's getting to the point now. Also, the Department of Justice busted a bunch of Russian money laundering guys who are operating in the United States that, you know, are doing business with companies on the sanctions list through Russia, blah, blah, blah. So the sanctions are tightening up. It's going to be harder for even other countries to do business with Russia. Like if China continues to buy, they're going to be put on sanctions, as I understand it. It's going to be pretty expansive. Do you think it's enough? What do you think?
I think the same thing I've always thought. Take all their money, take all their yachts, take all their villas, take all their docas, take all their shit, take all the jewelry, take the Instagram accounts away.
Yeah.
Of their kids.
Oh my God. No, we can't have that. Come on. You have to draw the line somewhere.
Take away their kids, you know, jets and ability to start clothing lines or whatever the hell they, you know, caviar, special stuff. And they just take it. Take
Do
it.
Their unfrozen embryos have Instagram accounts? I don't know.
I don't know. Probably. Just take it all and have it be, it's not coming back. You're not getting it back. It's not being held over here. Take it all and give it to Ukraine.
Yep.
And this shit will stop quick.
Yeah. Yep.
Take their wealth away.
Take it away.
Their wealth away. And even the folks that have been here, even in America, especially in the West, but even it's UK, you know, take their soccer teams.
Yeah. Take the soccer team away.
Yeah. Take their hedge funds away.
Yeah.
Take their talent agencies away.
Mm-hmm.
Take it away.
Yeah. The social media networks? Can we do that too?
Take away
the Can we somehow media? Reclaim Twitter? I don't know.
That would be fun. So if that stuff just gets seized and handed over to Ukraine, it's not coming back, and that will be continual. That on top of the sanctions, that'd do it. Just sanctions. I mean, Russia survived them before after Crimea. it actually strengthened their economy because instead of the money flowing out, it came back in. Remember, the reason I focus on seizing the assets so much as opposed to, I mean, the sanctions are fine, but these people make their money, so many of them make a tremendous amount of their wealth, not all, but so many. And the majority of their wealth is coming from illicit shit. It is.
Yeah.
They're in bed with crime syndicates and gangsters, and that's just the way it is. Sounds like I'm saying movie stuff again, but that the Russian economic system, the oligarchs who I call mobligarchs, the Kremlin connection to all these folks, the offshore accounts, all this stuff is known that there's heroin trafficking money. There's human trafficking money in terms of everything you can imagine there. There's nuclear material trafficking money. There's black market cigarettes even. It's a ton of underworld wealth. It's the core now of the second economy, which is the economy of the underworld. So you can sanction everything up above, but they're still making a shit ton, right?
Yeah.
You know, disrupt their shipping routes, seize their shit as they're, you know, put sanctions on their international partners.
I think they are doing that now.
That kind of stuff is helpful. And put pressure on places like Argentina, Brazil, like the places in South America that have been engaging with the Kremlin for decades and decades and decades and decades. So it's just, but just economic sanctions against the businesses that are above ground that we can all see is you're barely touching the money. They like to spend their money though. Boy, do they like to spend it. They like to buy shit. So take the shit they buy.
Yeah.
Just take it from them.
I mean, somebody's got to buy the Trump gold shoes, right?
Also making it so that they have to live there with Putin.
Yeah.
That's a big deal. You know, take their real estate away and put pressure on every single NATO ally. You do not give them residence.
Get the fuck out. Yeah.
And that'll stop it. They like their lifestyle. They like their Western lifestyle. They do.
Yeah. So. Even as they're destroying us. Makes no sense. Just quickly, I want to go through, you know, because again, it's 2 years now.
Yeah.
And I wrote about this back, I think even before it happened, about 2 years, you know, over 2 years ago.
Yeah.
Putin is clearly, you know, the parallels between Putin and Hitler are stark and obvious. And I know everybody's like, well, you're just comparing to Hitler. But I mean, in the way that they took power, there's a photo of Hitler who was given the chancellorship by, what's now, I can't remember his name. The big dude that was on the, I wrote it down and I can't remember. You know what I'm talking about. Not Dusseldorf. He's got a name like that.
Oh.
Yeah. And they're shaking hands and he's much bigger. And Hitler's this tiny guy, right? And then there's, Hindenburg.
Yes, thank God.
Yeah, Hindenburg. Sorry. And then I knew I was going to forget this. I wrote it down on a piece of paper that I know. And then there's a picture of Yeltsin shaking hands with Putin. And it's the same thing. Big, bloated, old statesman and the young, smaller, you know, evil guy. So. That he's given power
little
to.
Psychopathic, then, torturing little animals.
Yes. Then there's a manufactured crisis, right? There was one in Nazi Germany. There's one in Moscow with the apartment bombings, which we know are FSB, that they were like, that's what they did. There's been lots of research about this. You can go Google it. This isn't like some conspiracy thing. This is a guy studied this.
No, it's just history.
In the international report, he blows up his own people to consolidate power. Then he starts eliminating his rivals. He starts killing journalists. He corrupts the judiciary, all to consolidate power over a period of time. What did Hitler do in the Sudetenland, in the Czech lands, right? In the Sudetenland, he said, these people speak German. They are German speakers. They want to belong to Germany. It really should be German land. This is the same shit that Putin did in Crimea, where he said, these are Russians. They don't want to be in Ukraine. These are Russian speakers. You're treating them badly. We need to protect our Russian people. And that's the excuse that Hitler used to go in his Sudetenland is the same excuse that Putin used to go into Crimea. And then what happens? There's more diplomacy. We have to calm down. You know, Obama, we're going to sanction. Okay, there's everything's all right for a while. Peace in our time. And then Hitler invades Poland. Putin invades Ukraine. So when Hitler invaded Poland, World War II was on. That was the red line. And unlike now, when everyone draws a fucking red line and then ignores it, when they did the red line, the world woke up and said, no, you can't, that's, you can't do that. So this is if like Hitler invaded Poland, but the Poles fought back and then just held on for 2 years, and France and England and all the other countries were just sitting there with their thumbs up their ass. That's what's happening now. That's the parallel right now. All we need to do for Ukraine to win is give them fucking money and arms. That's all that it requires. Europe is doing it. If we did it in the right way and Europe did it in the right way, the cost of defeating Russia is so cheap relative to anything else that we could be doing that it's stupid not to do it. Victor
and Rudd, the benefit
over and over and over. It's a huge benefit, right? There's no troops on the ground. There's no American soldiers lost. There's nothing. They just need the fucking guns. That's all they need. And the people that are preventing them from having the guns are the Republicans in Congress. They are all traitors. They are all working for Putin. And that's who they are. And this stink is going to be on them until the day they die, which I hope is soon. Every last motherfucking one of them.
Yeah, I so agree with you. And it's interesting that... I mean, we're kind of jumping through some eras here, right? So, yeah. So what we're really talking about, these sort of the last 80 years, yeah. Right? The last 80 years, almost 90. Is it almost 90? It's almost
D-Day was 80 years ago this year. So,
okay, last 80 years. So, and that we had right in the center of that, we had the 1980s, where it was a very clear Cold War, mm-hmm. and the propaganda machine was fully lit on both ends, right? You know, had Reagan and his propaganda about America, you know, and ridiculous movies that were we were all watching. So I feel like we've got this thing where we just keep coming back to, I don't know who these, I can't believe almost. And my dad said this the other morning. He was like, I just can't believe I've lived through in my lifetime, this party, the Republicans, becoming a fully owned extension or arm of the Russians, of the Kremlin. It just is yet another thing that tells you and shows you that everything they said all those years, all that propaganda they were peddling, all that was just, remember the anti-com, the Red Scare, all of that was bullshit. They didn't mean any of it. None of it. It's all been a lie. They just didn't mean any of it. And I know it kind of feels like there were some real Republicans at some point in time. And then I don't think so.
I don't know. I mean, you don't think, I think if Reagan woke up now and they explained what was going on, he would be appalled. I really do.
I don't think so.
Yeah. No, he was a cold warrior. I think he was a true believer in the
end. I think he was pretty much, back in California, put into power by the same people put Nixon into power, on a state level. He was pretty tied into the same corruption. So I don't know. I don't think so, Greg. I really think the more I like to look in things, like it was just all for power. It was just all bullshit for power. And now this is for power.
Can we unfreeze Reagan and ask him?
Is he frozen?
I don't know.
That would be interesting. I sometimes wonder who froze themselves. I think people froze themselves and didn't tell us. Not that you can freeze someone and bring them back to life, but maybe. All right. So that's just, my theme is, I don't believe any of it from that bench. Let's put it that way. But go back on the miracle on the ice.
Yeah.
That was always the Russia bench.
Yeah. Yep. Unbelievable. Yeah.
It's unbelievable. Yeah.
Say it's what you really will about the John Birch Society. At least they hated the fucking Russians.
There's so much. We'll get into it. Let's do a John Birch. We'll come back to that. Again, okay. It's fascinating how many ties to the KGB in the origins of the John Birch Society one can find. There's so much that's just been theater and just garbage. Just nonsense, funded and fueled, if not sort of puppeted in some way or infected in some way at a point, maybe once something, right, within American political society got enough power or attention, in they come to fuck it all up. And by they, I don't mean to sound conspiratorial, I mean our enemies who study us very, very well and very closely, because we're an open society. So everything we do, they can watch and study and have for decades and decades and decades, and just come in and get the better of us. And we just have no idea what's going on. We just go, you know, it's like a fish hook in the lip. Americans are so easily baited and hooked and just drug along some path of just utter garbage, nonsense, bullshit.
Yeah.
Like pro-life. I can't. Ah! Yeah, that's my sound for it all.
Oh my God, we forgot. Because we're off. We forgot to do the thing.
We went to the Power Media. I
knew something was off. I knew we were forgetting.
All right, well. All right, we'll do it.
Now, this is a good lead-in, because you know what? What do we have to say about the world right now? I don't know.
All right.
Times have changed. Soulless rich man, look what he owns. We can't pay off our student loans. So we lose ourselves in our fools. And tomorrow, Earth will turn to a dried up husk. We'll all die while the rich men flee off to Mars with Elon Musk.
For news we once had Walter Cronkite. Today it's a nightly gaslight of cable shows. Everything blows.
For many decades since John Marshall, our SCOTUS, it was impartial. Now it's fallen cold. Everything blows.
It's so dumb today and ho-hum today. I'm so numb today, David Frum today. When most guys today, reporters prize today, are just Peter Thiel tech bros.
Trump is such a sick, depraved guy. I'm praying we'll all be saved by the UFOs.
Everything blows.
I'm so mortified by the voice. It's terrible.
Chunk is so good.
It's terrible. So good. Chunk is so genius. Yeah. He saves us.
Yeah, he saved us. What were our vocal stylings?
So bad. Oh, and it's fitting with our like retro looking back moment. Yeah. So thank you for remembering. That. I had completely forgotten.
No, we can't. I mean, he. You know, we. I would have remembered at some point. We're not that late, anyway. Okay. So.
Okay. Good.
We got two more topics.
All right, two more topics. I'm starting the timer. Taxman.
Okay, Taxman. This is a quick.
Yeah.
I had on my podcast Michael Gratz, who is a law professor for many years at Columbia and Yale Law. He worked in the Treasury Department. He's retired now, and he writes books, and he wrote this book called The Power to Destroy, How the Anti-Tax Movement Hijacked America. And I had him on the podcast, and I read the book, and it's which came out, I think, last week. And it was fascinating. Like like I told him, I mean, if you're going to market something with a three letter word ending in X, tax is not the word you would pick. Right. So, you know, the taxes are boring. They're dull. It's like, oh my God, tax law. But it's really a fascinating book because it's sort of like the evil geniuses of this movement. Right. Because it was a concentrated movement with a weird coalition of basically weirdos. Who didn't want to pay taxes for various reasons. Social conservatives who didn't want to pay taxes because they didn't want their money helping black and brown people. Right. Evangelical Christians because they wanted their schools, especially in the South, they wanted their school, their private religious schools that they founded so that they could keep up the segregation to, you know, not be taxed. And then just rich assholes who didn't want to pay taxes. So all of those people combined together, you know, with a bunch of kooks like this Grover Norquist is just he's just a kook. What kind of person, what kind of human graduates from college and Harvard, he went to Harvard and thinks, you know what I'm going to spend my life doing? I think billionaires are taxed too much. I'm going to make it my life's work to make sure that they're taxed less. Who the fuck does that? Like what a ridiculous thing to, at least Leonard Leo has a religious reason for doing what he's doing. I mean, he believes it fully, but the tax thing is so just, fuck you, man. You know, it's just bizarre. And that guy, Arthur Laffer, I didn't really understand that. That was this guy just wrote like a dumb curve on a piece of paper and Reagan thought it was great. And then, you know, they put this thing together and they keep cutting taxes and cutting taxes and cutting taxes and cutting taxes. And I never really thought about how political taxes are, like in the sense that what we choose to tax, what we don't choose to tax, it shows what we as society values. So the Scandinavian countries that have higher taxes but give all the stuff back to the people so that they have things like, oh, I don't know, healthcare and good education and, you know, women can give birth and go take time off that's paid, all that stuff that civilized places should do, they value that as a society. And Americans, again, we're so dumb in a collective way. We don't understand that the fact that we all pay taxes goes to that and making all of our lives better. That if all of us paid more in taxes, we would pay significantly less in healthcare costs and we'd actually wind up saving money in the long run. It's too mathy for these people to get. So it's all of this tax stuff happened. It came out of the 70s. Reagan came in there, and Reagan, who was like, you know, came up as an actor during in the 50s when the top marginal rate was 91% and said, like, I only make three movies a year because the fourth movie is just, I just pay it to the government anyway. It's not worth doing. So he had his own personal grievance to do this kind of thing. And throughout this, it's just tax cut after tax cut and everything's lowered, you know, and you see things like Reagan, while talking about fiscal responsibility and balancing the budget and all this stuff, meanwhile, was spending money like the drunkest of drunken sailors.
Yeah.
And left with, when he took office, I think it was about $1 trillion in deficit. He left with 2.7 trillion. HW said he would not read my lips, no new taxes. And then he looked at the sheets and was like, oh, fuck, we have to raise taxes, because he was actually a responsible human. And so, of course, the voters were like, they said no taxes. So they got rid of him. Then Clinton came in and you know, left with a surplus, which fucking idiot boy, the profligate son in more ways than one, blew through. And Obama tried to clean that up, which was difficult because he came in after Bush came this close to tanking the entire global economy and, you know, got everything better. And now Trump is just, you know, as I wrote in the thing today, like he spent money as if Fred Trump is going to come down from heaven with like dollars in casino chips. And that's where we are now. And now you have these people like threatening the debt ceiling, which would be, you know, unimaginable folly. That's the way he did the book. I hadn't thought about it as this concentrated movement before, you know, as with evil geniuses. This book, which is called The Power to Destroy, it's like evil geniuses for this thing. So, and I really enjoy talking to him. So it was a cool, like, it's a good conversation. It's mostly him talking. So I'm not, but that's it. Had you ever thought about taxes in that way? Cause I never really thought about it that way before.
No, I don't think I had. And yeah. I'm not surprised.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
If you really think about it, there's no way there's not, it's such a agenda item for the rich mm-hmm. who became yeah. the you know, the donors to the GOP, and it's so transactional at its core that eventually you end up with the Trump, no matter what, right? You end up with Donald.
Yeah.
Because we're just going to have a purely transactional individual who has no, he'll just do anything we tell him to do as long as, you know, there's like a, we'll give you this and then you'll give us that. And I suppose you could say politics at its core has always been that way. So of course, the money, which is what taxes are in politics, right? Is going to just follow suit to the thing. But I do think we're entering into some new, cul-de-sac with the voters, with the voters. The politicians, I don't think, have changed. This is why I'm like, yeah, same old stuff, but grosser. Ugh. But what the general public is willing to tolerate, accept, ingest, believe in, you know, be radicalized by, is it's very dumb and very shallow now. So, and very just self-harming. Yeah. To no taxes is just, is a way to hurt yourself. That's, you're hurting yourself.
Yeah.
You know, you're hurting your the society that you're in. You're causing great damage to be in this belief set. You're kind of on a wing and a prayer that somehow you'll end up not needing the federal government to have the resources to come to your aid. It, you know, so yeah, it doesn't surprise me.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I guess that's all of the money in the most pure sense, right?
Yeah.
In terms of why are these politicians doing what they're doing?
Yeah. Yeah. The other thing he goes through just quickly is the sort of history of tax, because, you know, the history of the United States is the history of taxation in many ways. Like the first real U.S. thing that happened was the Boston Tea Party.
Boston Tea Party. Yeah.
But it's interesting because what they were protesting. Okay. So at that time, England was out of money because of the war with France or whatever. And the British East India Company was teetering on bankruptcy. And they had this, basically this, what do you call it? The exclusive right to sell tea to the United States. Mm-hmm. But the Dutch East India Company sold tea at like a third the price. So the British were like, no, 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 you can't do that. Da, da, da. So their excise tax wasn't helping us. It was just helping them.
Right.
So when they got rid of the tea and did all this stuff, it was a real, it wasn't like, we don't want to pay our taxes. It's like, we're paying.
We don't want you to take our money so we don't have it.
What are we getting out of this? A bunch of dickheads and red coats walking around. Fuck them. You know, we don't need that shit. So the difference now is that the taxation that these people are against is the very taxation that funds everything that we do. So, and now it's going to have to fund the debt, because I don't like talking about the debt ceiling because I don't really get it. And also kind of like the Rand Paul people talk about it a lot, which my antenna go up, but there is a point at which the debt will be so much that every amount of tax is going to be used to fund it. And that's not going to be great when that happens. Right. So rich people got to pay more taxes.
They yeah.
do. Yeah. That's it. Fuck you, Elon Musk. Okay.
Oh God.
Do you have any announcements?
No.
We want to say, you know, go ahead.
No, I want to get the fireplace is fixed. Okay. So I should be able to have a fire. We've had I've like some stuff has happened. It's all fine, but family stuff to where everyone around here is extra busy, kind of taking care of stuff. So that might calm down a little bit. So I'm hoping to get back in front of that fire and with my mask on, which I've been doing anyway. I don't know if the results are there, but
according to the comments, they are.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Beginning of the show, lots of comments about your skin and all
really?
That stuff.
Yeah. Oh, God. Okay. Good. Yeah. All right. Good. All right. Well, maybe it's working. Thank you, everybody, for paying attention. Mm-hmm. So anyway, so that would be, but I can't guarantee it right now because we're still in the thick of a little family thing. But I'll have time. I hope I have time soon.
Yeah, good.
Yeah.
And then we've started doing these clips and these shorts and these things on the YouTube that you might have seen. I think people seem to like them. We do not create them. So they're sort of a surprise to us when they appear. And it's a pleasant surprise. And I do not like watching myself on the TV. I do not like it. So.
I don't really like it either. What I really, really don't like is hearing my voice singing. So I think that's going to stop.
No, the
butchering of Cole Porter. And I'm not fishing for compliments. Don't waste your comments. Talk to each other. Share love for one another. I don't need backup on this. I really am okay. I'm an excellent ice skater. I'm the Rain Man of ice skating.
All right. Well, we need video or it didn't happen.
Let's
go to GPT video of LB ice skating doing tricks.
I can skate on one leg. I can skate. I can hold my balance and skate on one leg and extend my, I don't know what the fuck that's called, and hold my leg out going forward without falling.
I can't even do that when I'm flat on the ground.
Two lessons. So.
Yeah.
Two lessons.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I'll get some video. Maybe I'll get some video.
And we want to thank everybody for watching and supporting. And I know people have been buying other people memberships, and we think that's great. And thank you for that.
That is so great.
We're very blessed to have this lovely community here.
I love this community. It's amazing. You guys are really wonderful.
They're great.
I just love it.
Yep.
All right. And don't forget to subscribe. If you haven't subscribed, hit the likes. That's always helps us out. And then the memberships, as Greg said, there are some people gifting, but we make that threshold so low. The memberships do really help us. As we say, we've got clips going. We are doing stuff with it. And the more support we have, the more we're able to do. So we appreciate all that support. And we love seeing you guys when we do have our after hours, and we'll be having another one of those soon too. We couldn't tonight because everybody's
it's too crazy.
Yeah. It's too crazy tonight, but soon.
Well, we're coming around.
Coming back with a great guest.
Yeah, we are.
And I know you don't want to jinx it, so I won't say the name. We have a great guest next week, we have actually several booked out. So
we have people lined up. We're actually starting to. Yeah,
March is going to be great.
Oh, the other announcement I have is that I went on the weekend show, the Anthony Davis weekend show.
That's right.
On Midas Touch. And we recorded it earlier and it dropped on Sunday and I saw how many people were watching and I had like a mild panic attack, but I think it was okay. I think it was good.
It's great.
So, yeah. So anyway, if you want to check that out. Yeah. It was actually kind of fun because I'm either ranting or I'm interviewing somebody and it was nice to be on the other side and have people ask me questions.
It's kind of
nice switcheroo. I like that.
Okay, awesome. I think I am doing a podcast. I'm going on somebody's show on Sunday.
I don't know when
it's going to drop or what's going to happen with it. So I'll post about it when it, so check Twitter and I'll
Did
post
you do it yet or is it live?
No, so I don't know.
Okay. Yeah.
I agreed to it, but I think we're taping it. I think it's taped on Sunday, so I don't know when it will come out, but I'll let everybody know.
Oh, the other thing for mine is that I got sick of the background. So I got my ironing board and I shifted things so you can see the map the cool World War One map in my office. So if you want a different view of my office, that's another reason to
watch. That's another view.
Yeah. My hair looks
good. I love it. Okay. All right. Last topic.
Last topic is et cetera. So quickly, I'm just going to throw some things out. Just some topics. Just some things that are not worthy maybe of their own. Yeah. Wayne LaPierre has to pay a bunch of money now back to the NRA, which is both good and bad, I guess. Because fuck Wayne LaPierre, but also do I want the NRA to have $4.5 million? No, not really. I don't know. I was kind of hoping he would go to jail. I don't know. Why is he not going to jail?
I know. Or be banned. You know, listen, he's a bad, bad man.
The worst.
So I don't think there's anything wrong with getting rid of horrible people and getting them out. And he was out anyway, but also to sort of demonstrate to that organization, I think the one plus side of it is, and what's happened, guys, is he defrauded the NRA. Surprise! He's a bad guy. He's a criminal. Mm-hmm. So so he defrauded them. They did a lot of stuff in the NRA as an organization under his leadership. Did a lot of things that violated the sort of rules of what you're supposed to be doing when you're a nonprofit organization set up in New York. So, you know, you have to meet these criteria. And for everything that you do, you've got to take notes. You have to have a real board. You can't just siphon money, put it in your pockets. You can't pay people. You can't bribe people. You can't, like, there are rules. And as an official registered organization, whether you're a corporate organization or a nonprofit organization, and there's different rules for each and variations of them all, you've got to kind of follow these rules. So of all the charges she brought up against him, she Letitia James declared this a massive victory, as it was. There was only one. I don't know how many she brought, but only one of them, the jury ruled, if we think that they, I think it was him taking a job after, he needed board approval to take some kind of job or payment after he was out as president. And so he did, that was the only thing he did by the rules that didn't violate New York state law or the, you know, the laws of the regulations within the organization itself. Everything else he did, it was just that she brought up against him, was just corrupt to the core. I mean, this man was a criminal thief to the, his own nonprofit. So there's financial consequences to him. It would be great to see, yes, him go to prison. It would be great for there to be more consequences to the NRA. But I do think it's a blow to them because this is it. The all eyes are on you now, NRA. You've got to abide by the rules, regulations, and laws of your nonprofit within and also within the state of New York. So all of that is a beneficial thing in my point of view to hold these, all these organizations up, you know, and sort of let them know you're under the microscope and you take a misstep and we're going to haul you into court. So good things come from that. I do think I do. We'll see. Yeah,
I'm not sad about it. I just, you know,
no, it would just would be great to be,
it's
like,
rush it up every time that, that there's a school shooting, Putin smiles. That's, it makes us look like a bunch of morons. And it makes Russia look better in comparison.
Yeah.
And that's why it's happening.
Yeah. And
sorry, it just is. That's why Russia infiltrated that organization. Okay. Trump's payout, according to Lawrence Tribe, I guess the judge thought it's something like 400. There's some very exact
it's
number.
It's like 67. It's the interest.
453, blah, blah, blah. And so, 5 cents. The 5 cents at the end was just, was a chef's kiss. Yeah. It was just a little fuck you. It was just the, here's a nickel.
He's got to put it in that nickels, Don. When is the date that he has to pony that up by?
I think it's soon. I honestly, I haven't been paying attention. I just, my sort of rule of thumb about stuff like this is alert me when he has to actually give the money over. Yeah. They're like, we've won this thing, but there's an appeal. It's like, no, then we didn't win shit. When it's when there's no more appeals,
I think he, I think it's line, sooner rather than later, even before getting it. I think he has to put that amount in, or the interest continues to accrue.
$53,000 a day, I think $58,000 a day, something like that. It's
That's
a lot.
Exciting.
Seems like it's a lot. Is it a lot?
I like
I don't know.
I
don't know.
I his, like his how much
orders are going to keep paying it, which is, you know, again, these are the same people that don't want to pay taxes. but they give this con man their money.
Yeah.
Make it make sense.
They give the guy who's bleeding at NATO and screaming and saying, and rest assured, he gets reelected. He's pulling the United States out of NATO. He is. He will do it.
Oh, yeah.
He's telling us it's there. So, but, you know, the whole reason being they don't pay their bills from the guy who can't. This is only one of his bills. This is just one. And he refuses to pay and he can't pay it. So I'll keep pointing that out. At some point, maybe someone will figure out how to hold him to that.
Yeah.
The amount of debt he has. My God. And getting it from mom and pop, you know. Again, Morning Joe made this point of the same today of like it's the same people who gave money to Jim and Tammy Faye Baker, right? It's just, it's so humiliating. He's just humiliating everybody. I think people are going to be just absolutely mortified at how much they put themselves into Donald Trump, to their whole world. Their friends, their family, their everything. There's going to come a point in time where it's going to be the most embarrassing fucking thing. And there's no escaping it now for all of these individuals who are all in with him and have been, despite him being an adjudicated rapist, despite him being an adjudicated fraudster, despite him having all the shit he's done for Putin, despite him, you know, being charged under the Espionage Act. Right, of stealing our secrets and handing them over to others, and they're just sort of out in the wild. And this just goes on and on and on and on. I do think there will be a reckoning. I do. I really do. And I think these folks are gonna crawl under their rocks because they're gonna need that rock.
Yeah.
They're gonna need the rock. It's not like they're forced under those rocks. It's not like they're night creatures and that's where they belong. They're going to just run for cover.
Yeah.
And hide.
I remember, you know, one of the first things I wrote about Trump was that I was really convinced that once people realized the conflict of interest and how he was just stealing their money and fooling them, that they would be pissed because no one likes to be like, you know, made a fool of in that way.
Yeah.
And I wrote that like 8 years ago, man. It's just, it hasn't happened.
It hasn't happened. Propaganda is very effective weapon of war.
So yeah.
It really does work. But like the cul-de-sac of, you know, eventually the abortion thing, it turns on itself. This is going to turn on itself. It's just a matter of time.
Yeah.
Now, it might be a long time if he gets back in and tears shit down and starts putting, you know, starts Navalny-ing all of us. By the way, that's one thing that I want to talk about this for one quick second before we go. One of my et ceteras was, I guess it was Laura Ingraham who was interviewing Donald this week about Navalny and asking his opinion. And he was like, I'm Navalny. And all of a sudden, and there's a huge runway there for someone to land a great plane.
Yeah.
If they wanted to, anybody else who can get him in that lane, because again, this is when it's sort of like, okay, this is this bullshit that you're peddling. It's going to bite you now.
Yeah,
because he's so fluid with it, right? With his Provoskaya, he's so learned in it, but in and of itself, it's shallow. There's no depth to his the propaganda he's been trained in and how he uses it. So that's a sort of everybody knows the accuse the other as a type of propaganda, but there's appropriate as well. So. He's appropriated this thing of Navalny being murdered by Putin, right? He's appropriated just the effect of the persecution. I'm like him. That's me. You know, the Democrats are after me like that. I'm just, it's just politics, but they would throw me in. They're trying to throw me in prison. They're coming after me with prosecutors. These are all fake judges. This is all this stuff. The way to defeat that, if you're the journalist in the moment, which of course Laura Ingraham was never going to do, but if anyone else gets that chance, he's not going to get off that lane. He thinks that works, and she allowed it to work. And it's almost feels like, well, how do you counter that? Because he's flipped it, owned it, turned it on himself. And now what are we doing? We're not thinking about Putin, are we?
Yeah. Yep.
Right? We're just... That's a way of protecting Putin to do that, the appropriation and the diversion. But the way to call him out on it is when he says that, I'm like Navalny, I'm like, it's worse for me. I'm persecuted too. I'm Navalny. When he does it, you then put him to the test of who Navalny was. Oh, so you're a stand against Putin then. If you're Navalny, right, you're against Putin. Navalny was only persecuted because he stood up and said Putin is a criminal and a terrorist, and he was resisting him. Yeah. So you're now, if you're Navalny, you're doing that. What that does for him is it puts him on a spot where he's going to have to either agree with that, or he's going to have to qualify it, thereby giving Putin an out and protecting mm-hmm. Putin. It puts it to the test. Are you going to protect him in this now? Because now you're talking about it. Navalny was killed because he spoke out against Putin. So if you're Navalny, then you've spoken out against Putin. You think Putin's a criminal. You think Putin, just hold him into that. Anybody hold him in that space and watch what he does. Here's my theory about Trump. I think he's fucking terrified. I think, and I always thought, okay, he's going at the presidency because he thinks it can get him out of his legal trouble. He doesn't want to go to prison. He doesn't want to lose his money. He doesn't want to have to flee. But if I get the presidency, then I can get rid of everything. I can just destroy democracy. I can get rid of all these cases. I can weaponize the Department of Justice. I can do all my shit. And whew, I don't have to go to prison. I now, after watching this guy for a while, and specifically because of the way that he went hard in the paint as a private citizen to demonstrate that he still had control and influence over Congress and the Senate on only one issue. Mm-hmm. And what was that issue, Greg?
Ukraine. I believe the funding for Ukraine.
Ukraine. Mm-hmm. Remember, everybody, this was just a couple weeks ago. It was Mitch McConnell's turned his back on Ukraine. That all dies. They crafted this border thing for the border and the money. And Donald Trump called and put a stop to it. Now, if he was just trying to get back into office because for himself, to get out of his crimes for domestic reasons, it's a much better path for him. And he knows this because he's kind of done it before and tried this before, and it works for him to say, to not meddle in, let it all collapse and be fucked up. And because the Republican Party is just a bunch of clowns, and say, well, you know, if I was in there, we wouldn't be going through any of this. But this is what you get when you don't have me as your leader. So therefore, put me in as leader. That's what he would do. He wouldn't meddle. He wouldn't meddle in it. The only reason for him to meddle in this is to demonstrate, in my opinion, to demonstrate to one person, Vladimir Putin, that he, even if he's not in office, he still has power to help Putin. He's proving and demonstrating his value because he's fucking terrified.
Yep. I agree.
That the Navalny end of it that you're talking about? Are you terrified that this guy He's going to Novichok you because he doesn't need you anymore, because you have no value to him unless you are the president. Why is he so desperate to show that he's in control? He doesn't need that to be reelected. He doesn't. In fact, it probably doesn't help him.
Nope, it doesn't. Nope. I don't think he has a choice.
I don't think he has a choice.
One more quick thing that I want to talk about, or just bring up, not to end on a sad note, but this whole Next Benedict thing that happened this week, where this trans child was killed by bullies in the bathroom in a school in Oklahoma. It's such a horrible, horrible story that I don't really have anything to add about it. I'm still processing it, honestly. My thought really is that it's just so sad for everybody involved, and that everyone in that school's life is pretty much ruined now forever. Obviously, Next Benedict is the victim. That's the real sadness.
Yeah.
And the family there. But, you know, the kids that did that, the administration that allowed it to happen, the people that didn't call the ambulance, the community that fosters this kind of bullying and this kind of hatred, this transphobia, which is being perpetuated by the fucking GOP all over the place, because it's just a group of people that they're trying to demonize because they're all fucking fascist assholes. It's a reminder. And it's a horrible reminder that this stuff has real world repercussions, that their rhetoric has real world repercussions, and it really does hurt people, innocent people. It hurts children. And they go out there and they're talking about they're going to save the children. You know, they love to say they're going to save the children. They don't save children. That's manifestly not what they do. The GOP does other things to children, but they do not save them. They do not protect them. They do not care about them. And every vote that they make tells us this. So for them to say that is just a fucking lie. And that's it. That's all I have to say about it. But I just wanted to bring that up. Feel for the family and everybody, you know, the friends and all of it. It's just really sad. It's sad. And that's where we're headed. If Trump becomes president, we're headed for more of that. So
yeah, you
know, it's just
okay. So let's not let that happen.
It's not going to happen. He's going to lose.
It's not going to happen.
It's just going to be a landslide because what? Why?
We're going to get through it.